Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, Steve Jones Show, News Radio 1070 WKOK. Sean Carey here, and Steve will be there in just a moment in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors Ford Lincoln Hyundai, North 4th Street Auto Plaza Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia on the strip, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Lots of ways to get in contact with us. Our email is stevejones@wkok.com. That's stevejones@wkok.com. You can also find us on social media, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Twitter handle at Steve Jones PSU, and subscribe to our podcast. And if you're listening to us now on the podcast, appreciate the download. But if you haven't hit the subscribe button yet, come on, hit subscribe, because then when you do, we just drop the shows right to your smartphone and tablet, and you can listen to them anytime, anywhere. And you can always get access to at least 3 months of previous shows at stevejonesshow.com. So we're with you live till 5, then we will have the late-day news roundup, and then 6:45 tonight, Phillies baseball here on WKOK as the Braves try to get one step closer to nailing down their second consecutive National League East title. Hosting the Phillies tonight, it's the opener of a three-game series. Dallas Keuchel will be on the mound tonight for Atlanta, going up against Vince Velasquez. The Braves finished the weekend with a magic number 4, hoping to clinch the division title during this six-game homestand. With a record of 93-58, they've already clinched a spot in the playoffs, and the Phillies still struggling to remain alive in the wild card chase. Very frustrating with the 2-4 homestand ending with a 6-3 loss to the Boston Red Sox, and left the Phillies 4.5 games out of the wild card chase. They have their work cut out for us. That's what Bryce Harper said Sunday following the game. He was ejected on Sunday for arguing a strike call. And Vince Velasquez has never beaten the Braves. He's 0-6 with a 5.36 ERA. So we will have that for you tonight here on 1070 AM. First pitch will be at 7:20. Well, it has been a very busy 24 hours for the Pittsburgh Steelers. Yesterday, Pittsburgh placed Ben Roethlisberger on season-ending IR, promoted fellow quarterback Devlin Hodges to the 53-man roster, and then last night we received word that the Steelers traded for former Dolphins secondary Micah Fitzpatrick. And the hectic week continued earlier today before the Mike Tomlin press conference. The Steelers signed quarterback Paxton Lynch, a former number one, former first-round draft pick a couple of years ago, to their practice squad, and placing free safety Sean Davis on injured reserve. Davis was a 2016 second-round pick, and in the final year of his rookie contract. He is eligible to return to the team after Week 8. He is dealing with a torn labrum. So with Davis out, Fitzpatrick for sure will be going into the starting lineup for the Steelers on Sunday afternoon when they're out in San Francisco to take on the 49ers at 4:25. You'll be able to hear that live on 100.9 The Valley. 2:25 will be the coverage start time on Sunday afternoon. Also in the news, New York Giants have benched Eli Manning. They have elevated their first-round draft pick, taken number 6 overall in the spring, Daniel Jones, to the start for the New York Giants. And they'll be on the road this Sunday against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Coach Pat Shurmur said that he spoke with Eli this morning, told him that they're making a change, going with Daniel as the starter. Shermer also speaking with Daniel. Eli obviously disappointed, but said he would be always there, a good teammate, and continue to prepare to help this team win games. Daniel understands the challenge at hand and will be ready to play on Sunday. There's Daniel Jones out of Duke, number 6 overall pick. Strong spring and summer, 85.3% of his passes were completed in the preseason. 2 touchdown passes, no interceptions. Eli Manning is 38, made a franchise record 232 starts since replacing Kurt Warner in 2004 during Manning's rookie season. He's collected a pair of Super Bowl MVPs. Overall career record versus Tom Brady, 3-2. But ultimately, according to Pat Shermer, a move that he felt at this time was the best for his team. And in baseball, Pittsburgh Pirates relief pitcher Felipe Velasquez was arrested in Pittsburgh this morning on felony charges of pornography and soliciting a child. That's according to Florida law enforcement.
This is for the Pirates nightmarish. I mean, they have nothing to do with it, except it turns out he's their employee. But it's nightmarish for a season that's just been horrible to begin with. Now this. The report speaks for itself. Go ahead, continue with the report. At least outline why they decided to arrest him, because right now he's in the Allegheny County Jail.
So the announcement came from the Florida Department of Law Enforcement. The statement, the investigation started in August on Velasquez. They obtained information that the pitcher reportedly had a sexual relationship with a 13-year-old girl in Florida. She is now 15. Was continuing to have a relationship with Vasquez via text messaging and received a video from him in July where he was shown performing a sex act, according to the police statement. The mother of the alleged victim found the text and the photographs and the video as well, which included a screenshot of photographs to Vasquez to inform that her daughter was a minor. Vasquez has been put on administrative leave by Major League Baseball.
Yeah, that's procedural. That's all they can do. They can't do anything else with them at the moment. I think what baseball is doing is the right thing with this, and that is they've decided instead of doing an internal investigation themselves, they're going to let law enforcement just conduct their investigation.
The arrest was a third-degree felony charges of computer porn, solicitation of a child, providing obscene material to minors. He does face extradition to Florida, and his arraignment was scheduled for later today.
Yeah, it's in Lee County, Florida, is where he'll be extradited to. But again, I think Major League Baseball is doing the right thing. In other words, let's let the investigators investigate. In other words, instead of us doing an investigation, let's let the police, state police, and others conduct their investigation, and then we'll make a determination off of that. In other words, let the professionals do their job. And I've always found that to be the fair way above all doing it, because they have the resources to do it as opposed to an internal investigation. Internal investigation, you have a lot of people that aren't qualified in certain areas to be investigating. So let the investigators do it.
If Vasquez were to stay with the Pirates, he would be due $5.25 million next year and $7.25 million in 2021.
Okay. Wow.
But could they void his contract? That's easier said than done, though.
Yeah, because voiding a contract is not... some would think it's an easy thing to do in Major League Baseball or in professional sports. It actually is not. A lot of it depends on what the union guidelines happen to be and what was agreed on in the basic agreement. Even though something may seem like common sense, sometimes it isn't, because we don't know what's in the basic agreement when it comes to something like this. But I think that's one of those where there's really no need for Sean or me to comment on this, because I believe the report stands for itself. Just read the report. I think that that's commentary enough, because I mean everybody is thoroughly and completely disgusted by any behavior like that. Now, these are allegations. We'll find out how true they are. But I think the report stands on its own merits. Meanwhile, the Jets-Browns game last night. Let's give credit where credit is due. That was an absolutely awful game last night.
I watched the last 3 or 4 minutes of the first half, the first 3 or 4 minutes of the second half, and I checked out. I could not watch any more of that. That was
Checked out.
I checked out.
I mean, the last time we had somebody on this station check out was after the third series.
Third quarter, third series.
That is the absolute inside joke of all inside jokes that none of you should know about.
Check the report.
So should we tell them what the inside joke is?
No. I could stay with us. It's nothing crude or anything. It's nothing crude or lewd.
Not even in the least.
But it
was one of those where you were glad you weren't driving when I texted it back to you.
I wouldn't be here right now. We'd have to set up the remote box at my hospital bed right now if I to talk to you right now if that would happen.
Now, we'll just keep that between us, and I apologize to the audience because inside jokes on radio or TV are really bad.
Yeah. This one's
but we think it's funny.
It's very funny and very clean.
There's not a single thing about it that is wrong.
No.
In fact, there's nothing about that actually is wrong. Okay, we shouldn't continue with this.
Oh, my God, but that game last night was... Wow, where do you start? I mean, the Jets, they had 7 starters out of the lineup, and then they got to go to Luke Falk. They got to put him in because Trevor Siemian's now out for the year. He had ligament damage in his left ankle. That was just that was an insane tackle there by Myles Garrett, just planting him backwards, and his knee was bent, and it's like, not good.
Yeah, that was awful. It turned out, though, nothing broken. You know that? On Siemian? Nothing broken. So here's a question. I mean, the Browns beat the Jets. Does that count?
No, absolutely not. And look at take a look at the Browns' schedule here. I mean, coming up here in the not too distant future, they got to play the Patriots. They got to play the Rams. They got to play the Ravens. They got to play San Francisco. So all this hype that was dished in Cleveland's direction during the offseason. You know, things could come to a huge crashing halt, and the Browns could be, you know, back to Browning again here in about a month. Have to see.
Well, look. You know what's interesting about the NFL right now? As I think you have the usual 24 teams that all have playoff possibilities. But the bottom eight teams are really bad, especially the bottom two. I mean, it's obvious who the bottom two are. I mean, the Miami Dolphins and the Jets are the bottom two.
Well, Miami Dolphins are now on a quest for Tua. I mean, let's face it. I mean, they just want to stock draft picks up. They got, 5 first-round picks in the next 2 NFL drafts, 2020, 2021.
Yeah.
They're just looking to rebuild their team.
Yeah.
And it's a shame. I feel bad for Mike Gesicki.
Yeah, but you know, none of the checks have bounced. Don't feel too bad.
That's true. He's a quality guy. You'd want him on a quality.
You know darn well.
I'm preaching.
I think the world of Mike.
Preaching to the choir here, absolutely. But just a quality guy like that on the field, off the field, you just want him on a quality team.
Yeah, of course you do. It's. Speaking of quality, are we going to get for the roundtable on Thursday? Oh, that's right. The roundtable has to be tomorrow, doesn't it?
That's correct. Phillies day game on Thursday.
Well, we're going to get Greg Wetzel, right?
Slam dunk.
Okay. We're going to get Zach Showers.
And how about this? Just received from Zach Showers a few moments ago, already received his game notes for the Berwick game on Friday night. It's been a slow day.
What a pro.
Either that or it was a slow day at school today.
What a pro.
One of the two. Zach was not on playground duty today in the school. He was at his desk banging out Berwick game notes today.
Good job, Zach. Way to go.
Getting it done.
Do we have any idea when it comes to... You know where I'm going.
Oh, yeah.
Do we have any idea?
I'm banking on the chief right now at this point, unless something changes.
Is he just too good for us anymore?
I wouldn't say that. Just trying to stay above water.
I mean, because he did take some time off at one point a couple years ago.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Is he technically the interim play-by-play guy?
I could have sworn that title was taken off.
I can picture him right now shaking his head back and forth. I can't live like this.
Question is Mike Ferlazzo now purchasing his Daniel Jones jersey?
No, that's, I know.
That's the question.
Well, you know what? This is the difference between the Giants and the Steelers. The Steelers, through injury, will now find out whether their guy is the quarterback of the future. He'll get a 14-game audition to show it. It's in the long term, okay. It's not like he ousted anybody because it's through injury. For the Giants, they had to put themselves in a position where they had to oust somebody to do it. Look, when you draft a guy, and the Giants didn't draft Eli Manning, they actually drafted Phillip Rivers, and then they traded swap picks with the Chargers. But when they acquired Eli Manning, they acquired him with the idea that he would be their franchise quarterback, and this guy could win Super Bowls for them. That's why you draft or acquire, as in this case the Giants acquired Manning. You know, just like Ben Roethlisberger, when you draft a quarterback that high, you draft him with the idea, like, I hope this guy can win us some Super Bowls. Well, Roethlisberger's won two, and Manning's won two. So Manning has done, you know, he may be a 500 quarterback in the regular season, but when it came primetime and he had to deliver primetime, he was not just good, he was outstanding. So he, you know, Giants fans who through the first 20 Super Bowls had longed to hear the words that the New York Giants are Super Bowl champions, and Phil Simms delivered that, then Hostetler after that, right? Manning delivered two of those four, was a key part in two of the four. And not only that, he's been the guy that's been able to beat the Patriots. So the fans, I think to him, to the fans, he'll always be a beloved figure because he did that. You know, especially as time goes, he'll become more beloved in New York as time goes because of the fact that they won twice. But now he's 38 years old now. Well, the Giants are not going anywhere fast, so why not find out? Yeah, there's an old saying that Joe always told me that I firmly believe in. I'd rather play a guy a game too late than a game too early. I mean, there's a lot of merit to that. But the Mike Tomlin press conference is coming up in the next half hour. Oh, this should be intriguing. Then we'll have Joe Rutter later in the week with his take on all this. In fact, we're going to have Joe Rutter on tomorrow. We'll have Ryan Snyder at 4:06, Neil Coulong 4:35. Tomorrow, our high school roundtable. We may not even have a Shikalimi segment. And Donnie Collins and Joe Rutter tomorrow. Maybe we should do an on-air poll. Should we have a Shikalimi segment since there's so much drama every week as to who does it?
Well, I wouldn't say there's really a lot of drama, but we should still have a brave segment.
There's a lot of internal drama, though.
Well, but if there is, I'm not. I mean, I don't feel the effects of that, though.
Let's go with somebody who might have some time to do it. How about Suit Light? Suit Light, he's got time.
That's true. I don't think he. His job may not conflict. I would think. Yeah, there's a possibility there.
Let's think about that for a moment.
Yeah. During the break.
No, we don't need the break. Let's just think about it for a moment.
Okay.
If you want, we can vote. I vote no.
Okay.
How do you vote? Thinking about it.
I'm still thinking about it. Your name's on the show title, so you get final say.
Now, if you want, you can abstain.
I'll abstain. I'll plead the fifth.
That means the answer is no.
Well, sure. We don't want to put Suit Light in a compromising spot.
Right, let's think about his life to this point.
He found the girl of his dreams. He's doing better than we think.
Oh, he's doing terrific.
Oh, he outkicked
the question
his
now. Oh, can he get out of the house now, though?
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Still to come, the Mike Tomlin press conference from earlier today, where there was a lot of news between Ben Roethlisberger, Paxton Lynch, Minka Fitzpatrick. We'll have that in a few moments. Then in the next half hour, Ryan Snyder on Penn State football recruiting, especially after this weekend. Neil Coulong on the Steelers in the final half hour. Tomorrow, our high school football roundtable. Donnie Collins tomorrow at 4:06. And at 4:35, Joe Rutter from the Pittsburgh Tribune on the mess in Pittsburgh. So that's what we have coming up. And on the high school roundtable, we'll have the usual dependables on with us. I think it's a fair way to say it, don't you?
Dependable, sure.
Yeah.
Chief, very dependable.
Ugh. Like a rock. That broadcast team has the Rock of Gibraltar right there in the Chief, next to the glacier that's melting. How about those visuals?
Yes. Crystal clear.
All right. So let's get to the Steelers. Roethlisberger's out for the year. The question is whether it's Tommy John or not. That's really interesting, if it is. Mason Rudolph takes over quarterback. They make the deal of a first-round pick for Minka Fitzpatrick. They sign Paxton Lynch to the practice squad today. All that and more wrapped up in the Mike Tomlin press conference.
Good afternoon. We got a lot of things to talk about. We've been active, obviously, in the last 48 hours or 24 hours or so. First, I'll start at the quarterback position. Obviously, with Ben's elbow injury and it being deemed surgical, we had to make a few moves there. We did. We brought Hodges up from the practice squad. We thought he was our best option because of his experience with us throughout the offseason and into the preseason in terms of knowing what it is that we do. And obviously, we brought him back after we traded Josh, so he's been back into the fold last week. He knows the ins and outs of what's going on. He provides the best short-term options for us. We want to fortify a position with some depth, so we acquired Paxton Lynch and put him on our practice squad. The fact that he has practice squad eligibility provides awesome flexibility for us, where we can infuse him into the culture and teach him and evaluate him without occupying a 53-man roster spot. So those are some of the variables that came into the decision-making at the quarterback position. Obviously, we're disappointed for Ben, and you know, from a team perspective, we got a great deal of confidence in Mason. It's the natural process that is team sport. One man goes down, the next man steps up. We're excited about this opportunity for Mason, and we're looking forward to rallying around him and watching him meet the standard of expectation, to be quite honest with you. He's a second-year guy. We put a lot on second-year guys in terms of stepping up and growing. To this point, he's met some of those things. We often talk about it in other positions. It's probably a more fluid discussion in other positions, but really he's done a lot of the similar things. First, he showed up in great physical condition. And that allowed him to take off from there. I think if you evaluate his performance throughout the preseason, it is indicative of a guy that's taken a step. Obviously, he did some really good things for us in the game on Sunday. But over the long haul, as we continue to go through this thing, he'll have an opportunity to show you the steps that we expect second-year men to take. We've had a number of other injuries that caused us to make some subsequent moves. Sean Davis has been placed on IR with a shoulder injury. We went out and acquired Minka from the Dolphins. We really studied Minka really closely in the process of leading up to the draft. It was no secret that we were in the market for high-end safety. In fact, we ended up drafting Edmonds later in the round. We did our due diligence. We looked at Minka. We knew it was somewhat of a pipe dream because of his global position in the draft. But having gone down there for both Alabama Pro Days and interviewed him and spent time with him, it really made this process a clean process for Kevin and I in terms of decision-making, because we had spent that time with him. We did evaluate him, and we did have a great deal of comfort in his abilities. We're excited about infusing him into the fold. He will be playing the safety position this weekend in the game. We're going to quickly get him up to speed. He's on the ground now as we speak, and so we got almost a full week to prepare him to play. He's a sharp guy. That was very evident in getting to know him in the draft process. It's also really evident when you watch Miami Dolphin tape and see the myriad of things that they ask him to do during his time there positionally. He's played corner, outside corner, inside corner, both safety positions, sub-package linebacker positions. You can't do the many things that the Dolphins asked him to do schematically without being a really sharp guy. At some point, it's going to be an asset to us, but obviously in the short term, we're not going to move him around a great deal. This first time out, we're going to anchor him down and allow him to focus on one position and put him in the very best position to be a positive contributor to our efforts this weekend that way. Really excited about that acquisition. Some other injuries that we'll sort through and get a sense of availability as we go through the week. First, let me start with Rosie Nix. He was out last week. We should anticipate him being out again this week. We had a number of other guys who have questionable availability, and that, as always, will be based on practice availability and then their participation within practice. Those guys are Vince Williams with a hamstring that's being evaluated and determining the degree of that, Chicolo with his foot, Connor with his knee, and Joe Hayden with his shoulder. Although I mentioned Joe Hayden was dealing with that shoulder a week ago, and he was able to play in the game with you know, no negative things really to speak of, probably go through a similar process this week in terms of getting him ready to play. So those are the medical things, the subsequent moves associated with those things. I'll say this, we feel comfortable with the team that we've assembled. Obviously, we deal with some circumstances that will force us to adjust and, you know, play a certain style that puts us in a position to win. We're willing and capable of doing that. You know, our level of expectations in terms of our performance will not change. It has not changed. We're getting on that plane and going out west to win a football game, but we got a lot of work between now and then. It's easy to talk about. It's more difficult to do. We're excited about rolling up our sleeves with the guys when they get in this building tomorrow and starting that process of formulating a plan that highlights their skills, and under the circumstances, we're going to be cautious in terms of some of the things that we ask them to do. We want them to play fast. We're going to have to play fast. We're playing against a team. Obviously, it's off to a hot start and it's got two significant road wins to start their season, and they're playing in their home opener, all of which we respect. I'll spend a little time talking about San Francisco, and then I'll open it up to questions. You know, they're a 2-0 outfit, and really, when you look at their tape, you see why they're 2-0. Last week, man, they ran the ball really well. They really leveled the playing field environmentally in terms of some of the things that's difficult about playing in Cincinnati. I thought they controlled the line of scrimmage. They ran the ball. They ran the ball with a number of backs. That allowed them to get significant chunks in the play action and misdirection passing game. But it starts there for us. We got to do a really good job of minimizing the run. They got an awesome supply of weapons in terms of the passing game, and it starts with George Kittle, their tight end. He's a special tight end. It's been fun just getting to watch him and getting familiar with some of the things that he does. He's significant in terms of the catching of the football, but his run after is really special, man. It's to watch a tight end turn short throws and catches into long gains and touchdowns is impressive. And he's not only got a couple of weeks of that, but he's got a career of that since he's been in San Francisco, man. We got to do a good job of minimizing him. At the wideout position, they got a stable of really quality guys. Goodwin, former Buffalo Bill, is really talented, two-sport guy, man, really athletic. He provides splash for him. They got a new weapon in Deebo Samuels, a really versatile wide receiver out of University of South Carolina. Man, he's good in the jet sweep game, reverse game. They work to get the ball in his hands in a variety of ways, much like the Gamecocks did when he played for those guys. They got a nice stable of backs. I know they've missed Tevin Coleman some, but, boy, they got a nice stable of backs. All of those guys are really quick to the perimeter and challenge you in terms of gap integrity. Garoppolo really kind of makes it all go, man. You see the comfort that he has within the system. I'd imagine, although he didn't get an opportunity to play physically a year ago, you see the growth and development in terms of intellect, in terms of his understanding of what they're asking him to do. He's a central reason why they're operating so fluidly on offense. If you look at them on the defensive side of the ball, much like Seattle, it's interesting how divisions might have personalities from time to time in aspects of play. Defensively, they got some strong similarities to Seattle and the Rams also. They're four down football teams. They play a lot of people up front. They have some people that specialize in quelling and minimizing the run. They have some people that specialize in getting after the quarterback in terms of rushing the passer. I'll highlight some of those guys in the passing game. The acquisition of Dee Ford is significant. The drafting of Bosa is significant. The two ends, the Oregon guys that are capable of playing as interior rushmen in passing situations are a formidable tandem, two guys that need to be dealt with. And at the linebacker level, much like we were talking about Wright and Wagner last week, we say the same thing about Quan Alexander and company on the second level in this group. They're a fundamentalist outfit. They play fast. They create turnovers. They ride the wave that their four-man rush provides. They produce splash plays, and I think you see that as evidence in the games that they've played thus far. I think they had two pick sixes in week one that allowed them to win in a hostile environment in Tampa in terms of getting the season started. So, man, I could talk for days. We got a lot of work ahead of us. But again, San Francisco and their challenges aside, we need to get focused on us and our divisional labor and the readiness of our men, given some of the things that I said earlier. And we're excited about doing it and putting together a plan that we can take out west to San Francisco this weekend. Be happy to address any questions.
Mike, do you have any specifics on the nature of Ben's injury and how long it might be before you can start the rehab process?
I do, but you guys know I try to avoid getting into specifics in this forum. I'm not a doctor, and I think, you know, a lot of those things will be confirmed when he gets his surgery. I'll probably wait until after that to get into specific details about what they found and the prognosis in terms of recovery. We released some statements, I think, yesterday that really kind of outline our collective sentiments as we sit here right now. And Ben released a statement as well. He fully intends to come back from this injury. And everything that we've heard, we're comfortable that is a strong possibility.
When is the surgery?
You know, I think it's being hardened up as we sit here right now. It'll be in the upcoming days, but I don't have a specific date and time as I stand here right now.
Mike, how would you characterize the phone call of Mason Monday?
He
talked about learning that he was going to be taken over.
He knew Sunday.
Mike,
You know, that doesn't require any conversations. You know, he went and played in a significant portion of the game on Sunday. I'd imagine he found out like everybody else. It's not something that you call a meeting for. He's more than ready for the opportunity. He aches for Ben, but at the same time, he's excited about having an opportunity to deliver for his teammates and ready to prove that his overall readiness.
How much of the decision to make the trade for Minkah Fitzpatrick was because of Sean's injury, and how much of it was because you saw an opportunity to get a good young
player? I think Sean's injury was a significant component of it, certainly.
A lot of people, since so rarely do the Steelers trade a first-round pick, I think going back to the late 60s, why this year, why now for this player at this time?
You know, I think it's just our overall level of comfort about the player, first and foremost. Like I mentioned, it was no secret that we were in the market for a safety when he came out. We did our due diligence on all of those guys. And, you know, obviously he was a guy that, you know, I went to Tuscaloosa twice. In the draft process for. So, you know, when you get in these circumstances where you're talking about possibilities, there was a sense of readiness, a sense of knowing among us about his capabilities, his character, his football abilities, and his abilities to fit within what we do. All of those boxes had been checked prior to the draft, and he's still very much a young guy. It's really exciting from our perspective to you know, we were excited about the potential of getting one of the top-notch safeties in that class, and you know, a short period of time later, we have a tandem from that class, and that's pretty exciting to think about those guys having an opportunity to play together as soon as this weekend. But big picture, to grow together systematically.
When you say Minkah is going to have, you'll keep him anchored this weekend to get him comfortable. Will that then limit his snap count, or can he get the full complement?
I don't anticipate. You know, that limiting his snap count. I mean that, you know, he's a multi-talented player. And at some point, we're going to utilize those talents as an asset to us. But we're going to get him started on a stable ground this week in terms of his contribution, and that means playing one position.
Based on his familiarity with the defense in just 1 week, will that change or limit the kind of defensive calls you're able to make Sunday?
I think we'll make that determination as we get closer to game time. But, again, based on what I know about him, researching him in the draft and looking at the myriad of things that he did while in Miami, I'm not concerned about this guy being able to play and play good football for us on a significant number of snaps this weekend.
Coach, your team's mental focus and psyche is so important to this season. Is this the most difficult challenge you've had in your career with Ben going down?
Man, I hadn't thought about that. You know, you guys know I'm not a big picture guy. There's enough significant challenges in front of us, and that's where we spend our time, not only in terms of Ben's injury, but, you know, we had a number of injuries in that game, significant players, Sean Davis and others. So, you know, it is our job to keep this train rolling as things of that nature happen. And if anything, from a competitor standpoint, man, it energizes me and us. We're excited about balling up our fists and fighting together.
Mike Tomlin at today's press conference. Next half hour, we'll hear from Ryan Snyder on Penn State football recruiting, especially after the weekend. Neil Coulong on the Steelers situation. Final half hour on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Sunbury Motors. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. Well, first of all, Minkah Fitzpatrick, I have to tell you a quick joke. This is really, you'll really like this a lot, Sean. Gary Vitarch, here in State College, I've known J.R. Vitarch was my next door neighbor for 11 years. And his brother Gary happens to be a season ticket holder for the Steelers. So this morning I see the brothers, and I said to them, he says to me, he says, oh, he says, I nearly had a heart attack last night. I said, what's wrong? He says, I'm reading the bottom line, right? And it says, Steelers acquire Fitzpatrick from Dolphins for a number one pick. And he says, I sat there and what, they gave up a number one pick for Ryan Fitzpatrick? Right? And you think about it,
Yeah.
Ben's hurt.
Yep.
This is the veteran replacement of all veteran replacements. He said, then I saw it was Minka Fitzpatrick. And, oh, good. He said, okay, I'll do that.
I didn't realize that's right. He's there, too. Ryan's there, too. Yeah. The journeyman.
Well, I laughed when I... like, oh, my goodness. Because, I mean, no offense. When he said it, I thought, yeah, you know what? I don't blame you for thinking that at all.
That's just a rare, crazy day. You get the announcement that your future Hall of Fame quarterback is down. They make a huge deal and give up their 2020 number one pick for next year's draft. I mean, just a lot of moving, a lot of shaking as the early season keeps moving along.
Yeah, but you know what, though? The Minka Fitzpatrick trade, obviously, if he's healthy. But it's, to be honest with you, I think that's a great trade.
And
I mean, he's 22 years old.
Yeah.
Hey, he is your first round pick next year, and you got him now.
Yeah, you only have to give him like less than $6 million, and with Sean Davis out now, it's a no brainer.
And it's not my money.
Your station for news, weather, business, and CBS Sports Radio. News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury, and on WKOK.com.